Hello, welcome to another program of Black Horizons. I'm your host, Hamid Rasheed. Today we've taken our cameras to Sir Robert Borden High School in Cole Harbour. Yesterday was a normal day back to school for most of Halifax County's school children. Not so for the students attending Sir Robert Borden High School in Cole Harbour. There's a dispute currently going on concerning busing which affects the residents of Cole Harbour, Forest Hills, and many of the black students who attend the schools in this area from the Preston area. We've taken our cameras on location, and we'll be talking with residents, concerned residents of the Forest Hills, Colby Village area, along with a number of black parents who are affected by this busing situation.
Yes, my name is Mr. Morton Simmonds. I'm a resident of the North Preston community.
Do you have children in Sir Robert Borden School?
Yes, I have. Matter of fact, I have two children in this school here.
What ages and what grades?
One of them in grade 7, in grade 8, and the other one's in grade 9.
And what brings you to Robert Borden this morning?
Well, my main concern to come here this morning is because there was people saying that the black kids would not be allowed in this school. Now, my child naturally is a black kid, and I'm very concerned of that, and that's the reason why I'm here.
You had heard rumors that the children, your child, might not be permitted inside the school?
Yes, I did. I heard this rumor, and I felt very concerned of this. That's the reason why I'm here today.
So you're here more or less to support your child?
Definitely.
I'm talking now to some concerned residents from... Why have you all shown up here at the school today?
We showed up because we were concerned for our children. And, well, there's a bit of fear in our minds of what is going on. To me, I feel that it is segregation right behind it. Well, the school can only host so many people, and if the people in this area are protesting and saying that they want their children to go to the school, in other words, they're telling us somebody got to go, and that somebody is the people from our area. And I believe truthfully that they are protesting in the wrong place. They should have taken their protest to the county building where the school board is. Right now, they're making it difficult for our own kids to concentrate on what they're doing because their presence inside the schoolhouse. And I believe that if we are the black people, we were doing such a thing, I believe someone would do something to have us removed from the premises. And I believe that maybe it's time for the government, the school board, to start considering this, because we're not disturbing any classes, but we're concerned about what effect they're having upon our children. And truthfully, they should be asking the opinion of the kids, and they'll find out that it's not the children who want to be disrupted from school. The children are satisfied with going to school, but I think that they may be influenced by the parents who are dissatisfied with the kids going to being bused to Graham Creighton.
Now in the gymnasium of Sir Robert Borden Junior High School, and we're talking to a number of students and concerned parents from the Colby Village and Forest Hills area. I'm talking to one lady who's particularly concerned that the issue be properly understood. What is the issue as far as you're concerned?
The issue is unnecessary busing. The school is in our community. The students should not be bused out. That is the issue. Unnecessary busing. Unnecessary is very important.
Some people have said that the issue is larger than that. That not only is it a question of busing, but it has to do with that there's a racial question involved as well. Do you agree with that?
I don't know. I disagree. I don't care if my child was being bused into Dartmouth. I would fight it on the basis that there is a school in this area.
I see. What you're here as part of a protest movement. What would you hope would be the outcome of your protest?
That our children would be allowed to go to the schools within walking distance of their homes.
Would you oppose, are you in opposition to busing of any kind? What about the people in the other parts of the subsystem that have to be bused to other schools? What are your views about, say, people who are bused from Eastern Passage?
Well, I feel that's up to them. If they don't have a school in their community, they have no choice but to be bused. But if there is a school there, then it's up to them. If they don't want them bused, I'm fighting for my child, for our area. The other groups will have their own problem. If they want their kids bused, that's up to them.
I see. I'm talking now with students. Where are you all from? Forest Hills?
Forest Hills.
Forest Hills?
Yep.
Talking largely with students from Forest Hills. And what are you all doing here this morning?
Sitting around doing nothing.
Protesting.
You're protesting. What are you protesting?
Protesting against the school board's decision to bus us out to Graham Creighton. Why can't we go to a school in our own community? That's what we want to know.
You want to go to school in your own community?
We do.
No. I see. The school board haven't told you why, eh?
No, well, really they haven't given us a specific reason. They've just said that, you know, you go here, so that's it.
Why are you here this morning?
Well, protesting is the same as him. I think the school board's gone doltish, and we should be going to the school in our community. What Morton can take is built to take 600, but it's only taking 400. What they can take us easily, 170 kids, 186, I think.
I see.
They should be able to take us easily.
Why are you here this morning?
Oh, depends on what, like, well, I don't know. We're just sitting around doing nothing. And they say we're trying to get into this school. They're not doing nothing. We're just sitting in the gym making the principal mad.
Yeah. Why are you here this morning?
Same thing as he is here for.
I see.
I don't care which school I go to.
You don't care which school you go to?
No.
You'd be just as happy to go to Graham Creighton?
No.
You'd sooner go here?
I'd rather go here, yeah.
Why would you sooner go here than Graham Creighton?
It's easier.
It's easier? What do you mean?
Faster. You can go up faster.
I see. You can walk to school faster?
Yeah.
I see. Now, if you go to Graham Creighton, will you have to be bus?
Yeah.
I see. Do you miss not being in school?
No.
No. No, we don't mind.
You don't mind at all?
I see. How long do you
think you guys will be here?
About 2 weeks.
A week to Friday.
A week.
No, because tomorrow I'm going to Graham Creighton.
I see. Are you prepared to stay here as long as it takes?
Yep.
Yeah.
I see. Is it fair to say that you take exception to the strategy that has been used by the residents? You feel that they perhaps should have voiced their protest in some other way rather than coming to the school to disrupt the children who are trying to concentrate on their studies?
Well, they openly stated that they were fighting against the school board. Now, this is not the school board. This is Sir Robert Borden, and our kids are in the school, and their kids are not registered. Now, they should have taken their protest right to the county building, rather than stay here and demand for them to come over to them here, they should go over there and let class go on, get on. Because I don't see, yesterday when I passed by some of the school classrooms, I noticed that some of the kids were in tension, had tension, and their mind weren't really on what was going on in the class. And I feel that it is have a detrimental effect upon our people.
What about some of the issues that are put forward by the residents of the Forest Hill and Cole Harbour area that... why should we have to bus our children when we have a school right in our backyard? What are your views on that?
Well, we have our elementaries being bused out of our community, 8, 9, 10, whatever the case may be. And they're up early in the morning through the winter storm and so forth. And when we were making that protest, we didn't like it, and we still don't like that idea, but we're contented with what's going on. As long as the kids get our children get a good education, and we learn to live with that. And I think that they're just going to have to learn to live with these problems, too.
I'm talking now with Ruth Bootler, who's a resident of Forest Hills. She's particularly concerned about, I believe you have two children that are in the school?
I have two that are supposed to come here, and I don't want them here.
You don't want them
here? I'm sorry. I don't want them at Graham Creighton.
Why do you not want them at
Graham Creighton? Of the program. I understand I have a daughter that came from primary right up through the system here, and she had to be bused for 2 years. I didn't mind that because there was no facilities available here in Cole Harbour. But now that there is, and I can't see why the children can't walk to school and save our tax money.
You commented about the program. You suggested the program would be better here at Robert Borden for your girls?
Yes.
Why is that?
In my particular case, I have two girls who are quite slow. Last year, I had a girl here in grade 7, and she was put in a, I think they call it a DR class, which is a class for not slower learners, but a class in which the approach to teaching was a bit different. They didn't take French, and the time that they spent in their French classes were put on English and English exercises and reading and whatnot. And she came through with tremendous 80 marks in the 80s and 90s. She missed 3 weeks of school, and she still had these good marks. But when she was in grade 6, she didn't pass a thing. She came here, and I couldn't get over the difference. And now I have another daughter.
She came here to
Sir Robert Borden last year. I have another daughter now in grade 7 in the same situation, and I have been told that at Graham Creighton there is no such class. The children are put in a class, in a regular classroom, and then the subjects that they are slow in, they will go to a resource teacher, and I don't agree with that.
How would you like to see the situation resolve itself?
Well, if this the school board is hoping to promote integration, I'm all for it. And I would believe that all our people are for it. If they claim to be open, the school policy states that they're supposed to promote integration. Well, I feel that if the school board backed down from their position right now, and taking in consideration that they're up for a new school board very soon. Now, if they back down and give in to the residents of this area as to having the school, their kids, the children in this area bus to this school, then I can only see the alternative where our kids will be put back into Graham Creighton, where they were satisfied, but it was the school board decision to have them brought here and the other residents in this area, students, be taken to Graham Creighton. If they back down on this position, then I look at it as going back, taking a step backward into segregation.
I'm talking now with Don Trider, supervisor of schools for the Dartmouth subsystem. Dartmouth Suburban Subsystem. Don, what's your view of the last couple of days' activities here? The parents from the communities of Preston and the concerned residents from Cole Harbour and Forest Hills, how do you view the demonstration here yesterday and today?
Well, the residents of the Forest Hills area have been protesting the decision of the Municipal School Board to direct their students to, or a portion of their students, to the Graham Creighton Junior High School. The protest has been peaceful in nature, and they have not disrupted the normal activities of Sir Robert Borden Junior High to any extent. So from that point of view, it's been carried out in a very acceptable manner. Now, the length of time, of course, is a question. Hopefully it will not linger for a long period of time, because at some point some inconvenience is going to be caused and some disruption to the normal program will result. The Education Committee of the School Board, at its regular meeting next Wednesday, will consider a written request from the group for a meeting. And if a meeting is to be held with the group, it will be held at some time after the Wednesday Education Committee meeting. However, there's been no indication whether or not the Education Committee will rule in favor of a meeting. That will have to be debated.
The residents from these areas have said, have taken exception to the fact that their children have to be bused from their community when they have schools right in the areas where they live. What is the school board position on that?
Well, you know, to a certain extent, they're correct. That is, for the current year, in all probability, we could accommodate those students at Sir Robert Borden Junior High School. I would have to wait until I see the final figures before I can confirm that, but I suspect that would be the case. Next year, I cannot guarantee that, and the third year, with the growth in population, the school would most certainly exceed capacity if these students were permitted to attend. Now, at the same time, we have the Graham Creighton Junior High School in an area of declining enrollment, generally speaking, so that over the same three-year period, the enrollment of that school is decreasing and empty classrooms are popping up. So the distribution scheme attempted to make the best use of existing facilities within a relatively confined area. The Graham Creighton School is 3 to 4 miles away. It's on the periphery of the Forest Hills area, and the board sees as a logical solution to make use of the existing classroom space, as opposed to eventually adding expensive capital costs with additions to facilities within the area.
The board, in arriving at a decision, appears to have made an attempt to balance things off in a regional context. That is, a number of people, for example, the people from Eastern Passage, I understand, have to be bused several miles to go to school. And it seems that The board, in arriving at its current decision, has attempted to balance the distance bused by all communities off, so that there's a perhaps what you might say a fair amount of distance that have to be traveled by each of the communities that are involved. Is that a fair assessment on my part?
Well, that's sort of an underlying factor. It wasn't one of the principles to balance off the distance to be bused. It came out in another way. That is, some residents at the public meetings were saying that the board cannot afford to build schools on every corner. That was the way it was put. And
right.
I suppose there's a lot of truth to that. And in essence, that's what I was saying as well. And that we want to make the best use of existing classroom space.
I see. So then, well, would it be fair to say that you personally support the decision, this current decision that's been taken by the board?
Well, as a
or have
staff,
your views been changed at all as a result of the current situation?
No. As a staff person and someone very actively involved in the preparation of the redistribution scheme, I certainly support it. And I see it as the best distribution scheme that we could possibly come up with, given all the different factors. It's a situation where there's no perfect solution. Any other solution would presumably violate one of our principles, and we'd be standing at another school this morning instead of Sir Robert Borden. So given all of the factors involved, there was no perfect solution. And the board has come up with a redistribution plan which presumably accommodates the most number of children.
This issue is not a new issue, Don. I guess it goes back almost a year now, and throughout that time, a number of people have raised the question as to whether or not this issue is a busing issue or really if it has racial overtones. What's your view on that?
Well, I'm of the opinion that it does not have racial overtones, and to support that, I refer to the alternatives that were presented by the Cole Harbour group. And in each of those alternatives, the principle of integration was adequately provided for, most adequately provided for. They, at no time, did that group drop the integration principle. So I use that as a basis for supporting my view that it isn't a racial issue. Now, you know, we have individuals who are going to harbor their own opinions, and certainly there are strong opinions one way or the other, but I feel quite certain, speaking for the Cole Harbour people generally, that is their view, that it isn't a racial issue, generally speaking.
So that, in your opinion, the fears expressed by many members of the black community that the residents really don't like the idea of having their children in schools where there are a large number of black students is really unfounded, that they have, in fact, in their proposals, allowed for the integration factor to be taken into consideration.
I think so. I hope that's correct. I sincerely do. I have, at this point, I have no reason to believe otherwise.
Don, I'm curious about the impact of these demonstrations on the children themselves. I was here early this morning and I observed a number of the children, both black and white, coming to school hand in hand, seemingly as though things were normal. I also noticed in the gymnasium a number of kids who expressed a desire to go on and join classes, their classes at Graham Creighton. Have you had much contact with the young people in terms of this thing? What do you think the young people's views are on this whole question?
Well, they're mixed. I was approached by a small group of students this morning for transportation to Graham Creighton. They want to get their classes underway, and certainly we can provide that transportation immediately. However, we must have the permission of the parents. I wouldn't feel right in taking them without that permission. So there are a number of students who wish to get underway at Graham Creighton, and at the same time, I sensed yesterday that there were a number of students who were strongly in support of their parents, and they wanted to hold out with them. But I noticed a number approaching me this morning seemed to be a little larger than yesterday.
Would these be some of the students whose parents aren't here this morning?
It seemed to be, yes. The students I was speaking to this morning, their parents were not in the building. They obviously were with someone else, and some other adult had been given permission just to be with those children.
Many people have said that this is not a racial issue at all. It simply relates to busing. How do you view it?
Well, some people that was here in the other group yesterday, some of the spokesmen tried to use that as some kind of strategy, I suppose, yesterday to state that we came here protesting and tried to make a racial thing out of it. But we've come to the point where we understand things. We hate to always looking at things like black and white, but we've been here long enough now, and we've known that almost everything that happened in our area, it always have to, and it always do, affect black and white. And there's no other way that we can look at it. We had our difficult times at the Graham Creighton High School, and we know how the people reacted when the black and white were going in the one building there. So it's pretty hard for us not to think that it's not a black and white issue. The way I see it, in the minds of some of those residents, they're probably saying to themselves, and from our own interpretation, well, the school that Graham Creighton is in the black area, let the blacks go to that school. And Sir Robert Borden is here in our community. Let the white come here. And they point out that they have a mandate. The promises from the government when they plan on developing the Kobe Village area that all the facilities will be for their convenience. And this is their argument now, that the government went back on their plans. So I see it as a black-white issue. I don't like to blow it out of proportion, but right now our kids are registered in the school. And you just cannot overlook the fact that if we are in the school and they're one not in the school, this school, it has to be a black-and-white issue.
Don, the residents that are involved in this, is it the Colby Village and Forest Hills residents that are involved in the protest?
Well, not exactly, Art. The parents involved in the protest now come mainly from an area that we designate as the Colonel John Stewart Elementary School area and phases 7 and 8 of Forest Hills. So essentially the people who feel they have been aggrieved by the school board decision come from the Forest Hills area.
That's interesting. At one time, I understand that the Colby Village residents were also involved. It was a joint effort between the Colby Village and Forest Hills.
I don't know to what extent the Colby Village people are involved now, but my knowledge of the parents who are here today leads me to believe that they are from the Forest Hills area. There may be some Colby Village people here, but essentially it is the Forest Hills area.
I'm talking now with Licentiate Bruce Johnson from the community of North Preston. Well, we were chatting earlier, Bruce. You touched on another very important concern that you have relating to education of black students in the Dartmouth subsystem. Could you comment on that for me?
Yes, well, we're not just interested in the our kids going to the school, but we have greater concern, which is the quality of education that our kids are getting.
Would you say that the criticism that you're leveling concerning the quality of education relates to all of the feeder schools in the Dartmouth subsystem that black children go to, or are you are your comments aimed at a particular school?
Well, I would say that I can only speak for the school that I attended and from the schools in the areas that I've seen. I can say that in the elementary level there has been a big improvement, and I was glad to see that big improvement. But the danger is after leaving elementary schools, coming into the school that are in the integrated schools here, the high school level, where our kids are not being getting the proper education. There's not enough attention shown to the problem that they're having. And I really do believe, through speaking through experience, that many of us has been put through the system and led to believe that we have been educated when we're not. Now, from my own experience, I considered myself, not just me considering myself, but my marks indicated to me that I was a fair student. And when I got to university just last year, after leaving high school, I learned from other people who sympathized and who could see that my education standard was far below the level of other people coming from other institutions.
Has the residents from the area given any consideration as to what can be done to correct the problems that you see existing in terms of quality of education in the schools?
Well, the fact that the parents today and yesterday has shown up when we did not even know what was going to come. We didn't even know if one person was going to show up. show you that they are concerned and they're willing to support. They are, most of our parents are not educated people, but they are showing the student now that they are concerned, and whatever they can do to support them, to upgrade their education, I believe they are prepared to go that length to do it for them.
I understand that you took issue with the demonstrators choosing Sir Robert Borden as location for their demonstration, and that you suggested to them that perhaps they should be carrying their cause to the county building or to the school board. I see many of them have left now. Did you suggest this to them, or?
Well, I suggested, and not just a suggestion, it was the truth that they were fighting not against the school board by being here, but they were actually fighting against the student, black and whites, that are in the classroom. And I felt that the appropriate place for them to protest was over at the county school board. And to let our student get along with, get on with their studies in the classroom.
We only have a few moments left in our program today, and before we sign off, we want to move quickly to Black Horizons Community News. Viewers of Black Horizons will recall that we're trying to have as a regular feature of our program news of community affairs in the community. If you have news of weddings, events, news of any kind, please forward your news to Black Horizons Community News, care of Dartmouth Cable 10, Post Office Box 1011, Dartmouth, Nova Scotia. Now, for this week's news, first of all, congratulations go out to Mr. Bernard Kane, who's going to be honored tonight at a testimonial dinner by the North Preston Home and School Association for 40 years of service in the community schools in the North Preston area. Next Thursday, September 13th, is a meeting of the directors of the East Preston Daycare Center will be held at the center at 7:30 p.m. On October 5th to 7th, our viewers are reminded of the Black United Front's 10th annual meeting, which will be held this year at the Lord Nelson Hotel, Halifax, or the Hotel Nova Scotian, Halifax. On November 2nd to 4th, the National Black Coalition of Canada will hold its annual meeting here in Halifax at the Holiday Inn. This is the first time in the history of the National Black Coalition of Canada that it's held its annual meeting in Nova Scotia. On November 10th will be the NBCC testimonial dinner, honoring Canada's first black cabinet minister in the person of Lincoln Alexander. This dinner will be held at the Sheraton Center, Toronto. That's our program for today. Thank you for watching Black Horizons. Welcome to another program of Black Horizons. I'm your host, Hamid Rasheed. Today we're very fortunate to have with us a special visitor to our province and to our program in the person of Reverend Henry Barnwell, who is the pastor of the First New Life Baptist Church in Phoenix, Arizona. My first question, Reverend Barnwell, is what brings you all the way from Phoenix, Arizona to our province of Nova Scotia?
Well, Hamid, I would say that I married a young lady from Hammonds Plains who is the daughter of Aubrey Wiley, and this is her home, and since we've been married, we've been coming down to the African United Baptist Association, which we have enjoyed. And we are here on vacation during this time, and we try to send our vacation around the time of the association.
I see. So you've come all that way to participate in the 126 sessions of the African United Baptist Association.
That's correct.
Right. Black Horizons, we were fortunate to be live on location at the association meetings this weekend past. We hope sometime in the very near future to do two or three programs on this year's association. So viewers of Black Horizon who might be interested in those sessions, watch for future programs of Black Horizons. We'll be going into the association meetings. What I'd like to do this afternoon is to talk about Reverend Barnwell, the man. Spend some time talking about your theology, your philosophical outlook on life, and then finally go into some of the things that you're doing with your church in Phoenix. First of all, Reverend Barnwell, the man, can you tell us something about yourself? For example, you're a clergyman. Why did you decide to pick this occupation as opposed to, say, law, medicine, any one of the other occupations that bright black men are going into today?
Well, I meant to be frankly to the point. It was not always my desire to be a minister. I had wanted to be a doctor. And really, to be factual about it, I think, in a sense, I am a doctor. I like to think in terms of doing open-heart surgery each Sunday morning.
Yes.
For the Word of God is like a two-edged sword. It cuts deep, and it cuts in the heart of man, cleansing him from his sin. Now, I was born in Florida, and I joined the United States Air Force. And I retired in 1974, of 20 years with the Air Force. And I went in the Air Force really because of the conviction of the Holy Spirit of this idea of becoming a minister, because of the anointing of the Holy Spirit. That's why I am a minister. And enlisted in the Air Force, I said, well, surely I'm not going to be a minister now because I can't be a minister if I'm in the Air Force. But that did not stop God's Holy Spirit from choosing and convicting me to the point of commitment and being a clergy.
I see. So you've very adeptly explained, I guess, quite often people look at the at one time people used to give the respect to the clergy that I think it deserves. It's perhaps one of them, we can think of it as perhaps one of the most noble professions that one could enter into, and I really found interesting the way in which you tackled the problem. It wasn't really, I guess what you're saying, wasn't really totally your own decision. You didn't have all the say in the matter. You were led, so to speak.
Right. I was anointed by the Holy Spirit. I did have a scholarship for Florida Normal Memorial Industrial College to study the ministry, but had I gone at that time on that scholarship, it would have been mere a profession, another than a profession. But because of the difficulties and the struggles of having to complete school after enlisting in the Air Force and on, having been married and going to school, I appreciate the struggle now. And I really sincerely believe this is the way God would have it be, that I am convinced now when I say to a person that God can and God will, I'm speaking not only from knowledge, but a personal experience.
I see. I'd like to move now, Reverend, into your mission, so to speak, your area of involvement in Phoenix. Can you tell us something about the First New Life Baptist Church, your program there? I understand you're very active, very involved with young people. Could you share some of...
Yes, Hammond, we have our congregation is a greater percentage of them is from 30 years mm-hmm. and below. Mm-hmm. Now we have in the activities of our young people on Saturday mornings, we have what we call Boys Brigade. And what takes place here is Christians and non-Christian, any young people in the community is invited. Mm-hmm. We go out and we reach out to the community to bring in these young people. And what they do is play basketball, softball, and we camp and swimming, and whatever is interest to the young people. We strive to communicate to them in that era. And then we bring them on into the congregation occasionally to let them participate and share with us some of the things, the activities that they are participating with. And this is not restricted to those that are baptized believers. This is for all of them. And in the activities, then we are able then to communicate to them what thus saith the Lord also.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So the objective, I guess, behind this kind of activity is to work both with Christian and non-Christian, so to speak, to try to develop a Christian personality.
Right.
Through involving young people in activities that they see as being pertinent, relevant to where they are at that particular juncture.
Right. And it's my belief that we must meet people where they are. Mm-hmm. You see, if we are talking to farmers, then we must talk something about farm life, something that a farmer understands. And so it is with the kids. They are involved, and today in the United States, there is a great deal of drug and alcohol abuse that kids are involved in. And so we have to meet these kids where they are. So consequently, we have to reach them on the level that they can understand us.
Yes, I think that's very important. In terms of getting the word to the young people, to get it understood, to have them to internalize it, to make it part of their outlook, do you have any special kind of Bible outreach, or how do you handle the Bible study, for example, in your church? Do you have a special program?
Okay. Yes. What we have in our congregation is we have what we call rap sessions. Mm-hmm. As a secretary to youth activities of a Zionist District Association, mm-hmm. we began in the local congregation, mm-hmm. and ease on into the association. Mm-hmm. And what this does, all of the young people in the area, we bring them in and we sit down with them and we let them do the talking. Mm-hmm. Okay, even in my local congregation, what I do from one to three times a year, I sit in the congregation with my wife, and we have 8 to 10 associate ministers, and 4 to 5 of them is 28, from 18 to 28 years of age. And so what we do, let them take complete control of the service.
Now, when you say associate ministers, would these be people from your congregation, trained
yes.
clerical people, or are these just trained lay people?
These are persons that are in Bible school,
yes.
Studying for the ministry,
yes.
and some that have been ordained for missionary activities throughout the association.
I see.
And these persons, they have complete control of the services. And you see what is taking place here. These young people have an opportunity of expressing themselves, and yet it's under a supervision mm-hmm. of the Holy Spirit, as well as guidance by myself as pastor of the church. Mm-hmm. And this is a measuring tool to me to see just what progress we're making in their delivery and their opportunity to participating while I sit and observe.
I see. I guess this also would lead you into your involvement with Ebony House, which I understand deals with problems of alcohol and drug abuse and misuse. Would you perhaps share a little bit about your involvement with Ebony House?
Okay, yes, we have Ebony House, and at the present time we have as director of the Ebony House a Methodist minister, one who were in the pastorate but felt that the Lord were leading him into this kind of ministry mm-hmm. with alcoholics and addicts, and consequently, as a board member, we are able then to kind of give direction in meeting the needs of the community, of the alcoholics and addicts in the community, and to let people know that they're concerned, as my role on the Ebony House Board is to involve all of the churches and the pastors possibly, because we have to face the reality and the fact. What have the black man have outside of the church, mm-hmm. where there is a support and unity? So we try to involve all of the churches in support of the Ebony House and these kind of ministries.
Another area of your involvement, which I found of interest, we were discussing before we went on air, was your involvement with Leon Sullivan. I've been very impressed with the kinds of things that he's been able to do with his economic work. And could you perhaps share some of your... I know you're active. I think you're a board member.
Right. I'm a board member of the local OIC.
Mm-hmm. OIC, perhaps we could just break that down for our viewers who might not be familiar.
Okay, Officer Industrialization Centers, right. And careers.
Yes.
And Mr. Sullivan, as we have him into our city, sponsored by the local OIC and the Interdenomination Ministerial Alliance.
Yes.
And we spend time with Mr. Sullivan, and we are in the process now of trying to bring in also the Interdenomination Ministerial Alliance and churches in the area of supporting OIC more than we have been. Now, if you've been following Mr. Sullivan lately, this past summer in Washington, whereas that his emphasis were on young people and job opportunities for them. And certainly this is an interest to me of preparing our young people to take their place in various jobs that is available to them. And we support Mr. Sullivan in this, and he has been a great asset to our area as far as young people being able to get jobs. Now we work with the OIC this summer and placing many of our young people. And I am a board member of the local OIC, and we're just excited about some of the things that we have in store. We're hoping that we'll have him in from time to time. We had him this past year in to speak at luncheons, banquet, but now we are going a step further is to bring him into our local churches mm-hmm. to speak, because this is where it started from. And we again must be reminded that he is a Baptist preacher.
Yes, I was going to make that point, that it is Reverend Leon.
Right.
Reverend Leon Sullivan.
Right.
Well, this is, I find interesting, because for so long in the West we find there's been this emphasis on separation of church and state, so to speak. Mm-hmm. I heard a young person remark the other day that we were talking about religion, and I asked him if you're religious. Yes, I'm religious. What's your religions have to say about this whole economic question, for example? Or we were talking about some of the young things that young people get involved in today that perhaps isn't most productive and in their own interest. And I said, what does your religion say about that? She says, oh, I try never to let my religion interfere with life. And I wonder, sometimes you begin to think that that kind of attitude perhaps is beginning to typify what people think about religion today. It's been sort of shoved off in the corner, and I've just been so interested in listening to your remarks, where your work and your mission, so to speak, seems to be dealing with the total man, so to speak. There isn't this separation of church and state, the secular from the religious. What's the philosophical basis? What do you...
Allow me to say it this way, Hammond. As president of the Interdenomination Ministerial Alliance and Vicinity. Now, our role as president of the alliance is to keep our community abreast of all that's going on. Mm-hmm. Now, if you notice and state, there is a lot of the pastors that are working and pastoring at the same time. Now, I hold that we must be concerned with the whole man, mm-hmm. because history tells us that it's been the black preacher mm-hmm. that's been the spokesman mm-hmm. for our race, and that is the only free man, really, when you stop to think about it, that speaks out and has some significant weight. And as the president of the alliance, we, in we have now gone to the point that we have an open door policy with the governor of our state, with the mayor of our city, county managers, and the county attorneys, and these persons. So where I'm coming from, we go to these people when there are things that we need in our community, when education, the superintendent of education of our state, we let them know that we are not satisfied, and we have them know that we are there. So if we are going to just stay within the walls of our local church buildings, then this really tells me that we're not concerned with the whole man concept. Now, better job opportunities. We need somebody to go to the labor unions to let them know that we are concerned, because I think that some of the working pastors would be able to devote more time to their ministry, which they've been called and chosen for, if their resource or finances were available to give them a decent salary. And this is, I think, probably one of the reasons we find so many of our pastors having to work, because of the lack of funds or resource of our people having decent jobs. That's not to say that we don't have some people with some very good job, but the thing, we can't become self-complacent and satisfied with just a little.
So then there's really no, it's not just a case of espousing, there's no separation, as I see it, in terms of the word and the deed, that it's not enough just to say that we should involve ourselves with the total man, but you must set about doing that in the marketplace.
Right.
Being engaged, being involved where people are at, not waiting till they come to your level, but going and seeking them out where they're at, and seeking to use the positive influences of the church to guide and to direct them and bring them to the straight path, so to speak.
Yeah.
Very, very commendable. I'd like to move into another area, and that is the your work with the Interdenominational Ministerial Alliance. This is a little quote I'd like to share with you. It says, "All faith is false. All faith is true. Truth is the shattered mirrors strewn in myriad bits, while each believes his little bit the whole to own." In terms of that, I see that as talking about the various communities of faith.
Mm-hmm.
You're president of the Interdenominational Ministerial Alliance. So I gather then that you support the notion of working together with other religious groups, people of other religious persuasions, for the greater good of the community.
Right. We must respect one another's belief. Now, when we talk of religion, we talk of a belief. Mm-hmm. And I hold that we live in democracy where everyone has the right of believing who they want to believe and what they want to believe. So I respect everyone. And in the community, as you notice, that we say interdenominational ministers and lions, Phoenix and vicinity. That includes everybody that have a religion. And I believe that it takes all of this, that for one common goal of saving humanity, this is what we must unite together for the cause of saving humanity, helping everyone, and getting what necessary for our community. Okay, now on the second part, truth, what is truth? And this brings in a doctrinal, this brings in an individual doctrinal difference. And I hold that because we come together on a common cause does not interfere with what my conviction are.
Yes.
To a commitment of knowing the Lord Jesus Christ as my personal Savior, if you please. You see, now, because the Bible said, what is truth? God's word is truth. And that's what we must live by. they...
Instead of then placing the emphasis on the doctrinal differences, there's enough common commonality between people of the various faiths. If you concentrate on the positive, work towards the greater good, as opposed to concentrating on those things which unify, as opposed to those things which bring about differences.
Right.
Everybody has the basic anchored in the belief, a firm belief in God, then coming to grips with the problems that are out there in the community. That's very positive. Yeah.
I think sometime we might tend to be insecure, afraid of being overcome by another's belief. But I hold that it's healthy that if we know and we are convinced of what we believe, know who we believe in, and persuaded that he's able to keep us against any wise enemy. You see, I can go anywhere because I know that the Lord Jesus Christ is my personal Savior, and there's none can change my mind because I know who I believe in, and I know that he's able to keep me. So why should I be afraid? What do I have to be afraid of? He is my refuge. He's my very present help in the time of trouble. So you can see where I'm coming from. All human beings, and especially as a black people, we need one another. We need to be together to the point that when we speak to anybody, that we know that we are together for a common cause of saving humanity. And then on the step further, on the doctrinal point, we don't have to worry about that if we know the Lord Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. Mm-hmm.
I guess, too, we live in a world transition. Once we used to speak of the world society. Mm-hmm. Now, because of the improvements in mass communication and travel, transportation systems, we really have got to begin to think in terms of a world community. And all of that suggests, and perhaps one of the greatest challenges to man is that grows out of that fact that we're really on our neighbor's doorstep, so to speak. Once what was once thousands of miles off is no longer the case today, and that there are various communities that make up that are part of this world community in terms of bringing about some kind of fellowship, then we have to perhaps be a little more open in terms of our outlook to one another for the sake of surviving as a world community, I suppose.
Right. I think in terms while you're talking there of the late Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., and I think this is a very good example of knowing the Lord Jesus Christ as one personal Savior and not allowing what one religion is hinder him from the work of Christ. Mm-hmm. You see, Christ, he didn't have any particular person in which he associated with, mm-hmm. The Sadducees, the publicans, and the sinners and all. You could find him there. And I think we saw this in the late Dr. King, that it doesn't matter. He said, we will all perish unless we come together. And I think that this holds true right now, and I think it's good for us to understand we must come together. And brother, your conviction must be lived out. Take a stand for what you believe in, but let's not slam and close the door in our brother's face.
Right. Very positive point. We only have time, Reverend, to go into one other point I'd like to get your comment on, and that has to do with this whole question of racial imagery in the churches. I'm particularly interested in getting your response to what you consider to be the psychological effect of some of the racial imagery that has become commonplace in many of our churches. I'm thinking particularly of the Caucasian portrayal of Christ. It's always present whenever you go into church, either in stained glass, on the wall, or whatever. I'd be interested in getting your comment in terms of what you consider to be the psychological effect of that, the impact of that kind of imagery on Caucasian and black alike.
I don't think we accept Christ, first of all, as being black, nor do we accept the fact that it's him being white. The Bible says he was a Jew. So I think there is those who leaves the black church, goes to a white church. And why? I like to think in terms of, for the most part, we have many people don't know who they are. They don't know what they are. Nor do they really know what they believe. For I hold that Christ is a God, is a spirit, God is love, and he's everywhere, and we must accept him by faith. And when we accept him by faith, we are contented to work for him wherever we are and wherever we may go. Now, I like to really leave this for us to think about in terms of the image. When we are able to love a person, disregarding the color of their skin, and do what we know is right to do, and take a stand of commitment to involve ourselves in our communities and look beyond of what you are advocating and what I'm advocating, and hear Christ saying, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. He's everything. What is it you need? You can hear him saying, I am that I am.
Reverend, unfortunately, we've run out of time. I wish we had more time to go on to explore this question, this whole question of the psychological effect of racial imagery in our places of worship, and some other points that I'd like very much to discuss with you as well. I want to thank you for coming on our program. I found many of your views to be a fresh breeze. I've enjoyed talking with you. Just before we sign off on our program today, I'd like to encourage all of our viewers of the Black Horizons program to forward any bits of news in terms of weddings, social activities, any events that are going on in your community to Black Horizons. We'd like to incorporate as a regular feature on our program a Black Horizons community news. If you have news items, send them to Black Horizons in care of 1806 Water Street, Halifax, Nova Scotia. That's our program for today. See you next time.